When you do direct plays, the ones I've seen, they're, among other wonderful qualities, they're clear. They're very clear. Country Wife was in its own way clear. Timon of Athens, which I remember, this clear world. Lear, clear another way. Henry V, there's a clarity to them, and I don't mean that I hear everything distinctly, but I mean a clarity of vision. I don't know. It's not muddy in any way. The vision is clear all the way through, which focuses and slightly electrifies it. How do you do that?
Well, I think I have a passion for the story to be clear, the narrative to be clear. But when it comes to a scene like, you know, putting out Gloucester's eyes, it's a scene of incredible brutality and possibly a sort of sick, sexy sharing of an excitement between Regan and her husband, Cornwall. And the horror of removing one eyeball and choosing to do it with the spur. So it's extremely painful, and there's a great scream. And then he's got to do the other one. And it happens in absolutely pin-still silence. No scream, nothing. Which is more frightening than a scream, if it, you know, make it work. Well, that's detail, that's clarity, that's, you know, what's the challenge? The challenge is to show this. And so you do it. I mean, maybe I sound as if I really rejoice at an opportunity to be cruel.
No.
But to...
It sounds as if you've decided clearly what the story of that disemboweling, you've decided clearly what the story of taking his eyes out is about.
Yeah.
You've decided the kind of key signature of that story, and then you make sure the actions fall into the key signature. That's what it sounds like.
Yeah.
And so how do you do that to the rest of the production? The way the dress is worn, the way the food is brought on, the way the actresses turn, the way they the way the crowd moves. How do you do that?
Designer helps you a lot. The designer, I mean, I had Leslie Hurry, who was a most marvelous designer, did Lear. And the clothes he gave them were very much Book of Kells inspired. And... Well, I guess that attitude to Lear, you know, you think Lear's monumental, it's meant to be sort of superhuman, and how did people who built Stonehenge, must have been really strong people. Then you realize they built Stonehenge not because they were strong, but because they were frightened. And then the whole of that sort of period of history, of Britain's history, falls more sensibly into shape. If you think, you know, this is fear of all kinds of weird things, weird gods, weird suspicions. And it was a big inspiration to that company, saying that. Right. Especially Franny Highland, because he was a Goneril. Lovely actress.
Yes.
Yeah. I appreciate what you say. It makes me proud that you thought that things were so clear.
No, but what you've just articulated is that the reason for power is fear. I don't want power unless I'm afraid.
That's
and
right.
Once you're clear on that, the world takes sharp focus.
That's right. That's right.
That's what I see. I remember The Country Wife and all the detail in The Country Wife.
Yeah.
You know, from the gout to the stool, from the footstool to the glasses to the whatever. Yeah. And that illuminated for me like a painting. It became, every part seemed to fit and resonate in some way with everything else.
Desmond was a huge inspiration in that. And also, I was feeling, I'm going to dare Guthrie. Guthrie said, you can't do 18th century comedy on this stage. It won't work. Well, we did one, and it worked. I mean, it could have been better, I'm sure, but it worked. We had some good fun with it.
It's said of you that when you were here in the Stratford years, that you brought a Canadian voice to the work, that you wanted Stratford to have a Canadian voice and not someone else's voice. How did you do that?
Did I do it?
It has been said. Well, there was the specific debate was, should the Stratford actors use a mid-Atlantic accent or an anglicized accent, or should they use the accent that they were born with?
I think they should use the accent that they were born with. I think I always have felt that. But certain things are made easier if they don't. For example, the word bean, which is a very English way of saying, if you just always make it bin, B-I-N. But it's true if you're dealing with as an Englishman looking after Shakespeare and dealing with an American cast, the same thing would apply. And some of the things I feel I learned from my contact with my Juilliard contact. One year when I had a young company here in the early 80s, I brought a lot of the Juilliard teachers with me because they were really outstanding quality people. And one of them was Elizabeth Smith for voice. And she had all kinds of things that were helpful. But I don't know, I don't think I was very conscious of it as a challenge, except that I didn't want people to talk English with an English accent, nor with an American accent. So what do? You're left with a Canadian accent. Mm-hmm. And it has a proximity, it has a feeling of being related to Scots quite often, because of the huge amount of Scottish population.
I think Bin is Irish. I've been there. I've been there. It's Northern Irish. I've been there.
Are you Northern Irish?
The root of the Ontario accent is Northern Irish. I'm
really?
Going downtown, eh?
Really?
Because we go up at the end, I'm going downtown, and that's Northern Irish. I'm going downtown, eh?
It shows a lack of confidence because you're never sure you should be going downtown. It sounds like, do you mind?
Yeah, and now we call it upspeak. Everything goes up.
Yeah, that's right.
It's been a good interview. And is the
I'd rather have the upspeak than the downspeak.
I know.
Especially with Shakespeare.
Other actors, actresses, Fanny Hyland, who dear God is no longer with us, but yeah. She was a mainstay in the company at that time.
Yeah, lovely, highly intelligent, highly intellectual, very sensitive, very responsive, very loving of language, loving of literature. Lovely actress, tough as nails inside, which was very, very valuable in certain parts, especially Goneril.
Zoe Caldwell.
Zoe? Well, she just came straight from an affair with Albert Finney into the part of Rosaline here in 1961. And that she was real Aussie, she was an Aussie and very, very free. Perhaps a bit crass in some ways, you'd say, but she was a committed actress. Whatever you wanted her to do, she would do it with absolutely everything she could think of. And when I left here, I did direct, just soon after I left her, in Jean Brodie on Broadway, which she did very well, had a big success with it. Her last thing here was Cleopatra. God, that's a hard one. It's a hard play. With Chris as Anthony. He turned up very late for rehearsal. It was, the best sort of balanced way of doing it. It's a hard play because most Anthonys want to, feel they've won when they die. It's a great death. You can't do that because she's got a whole act of dying. You've got to be, it's like the ballet dancer who hands over totally to the ballerina. You've just got to get out of the way. And that's not the nature of Chris Plummer. When you've got a chance, he takes it. He was a much younger man then, of course, but Guthrie told me before I did, he said, well, it won't work, whatever you do. It doesn't work as a play. He was at the first night, said, I was right, it doesn't work. Not what I exactly wanted to hear at that moment, but still.
So when he says that, to you on opening night, what do you do? You turn to the wall, or you just put up a face and move on, or?
Well, no, he taught me when I did my first play at the Old Vic. It was about to start. It was the Othello, and he met me in the lobby. He saw me in the lobby, and he said, "Where are you going?" I said, "I'm going to watch." He said, "You crazy? You'll think everything is so slow. Come up to the office. I've got some new designs to look at. Let's look at them." And then every now and again, he said, let's go and watch the next showy bit. We'd go in, watch a bit, then go back to the office. That sense, why waste yourself if you know you're going to be thinking your own pulse is beating so much faster than anyone else's, so you think everything is so slow, when it may not be so slow. Do you know?
Is that why, do you watch opening nights as a director?
I found it very hard to do it here. I used to pace around there, drink quite a lot of liquor, and see if anyone came out to wonder why they came out. And I'd say any actors who had cause to come around the front of house during a performance because they had a strange entrance down an aisle, I wanted to know how they're going. I said, what are they doing? What are they doing in there? Listening. Okay, it's all right. But I think I'm a bit braver. I don't know what. I just realized that, you know, it's only a play, for goodness sake. We've done our best. I just want to see what they do and how an audience reacts. An audience is part of a play, part of a production.
When you watch an opening night, do you live the moments on stage, or do you? Can you watch from a...
I try and watch. If I'm with anyone, I want them to know that I'm not going to behave like they'd like me to. If I don't like something, I'll writhe physically. I can't stop myself.
Is that it? Oi. Oi.
No, I'm learning to do that, but I mean, I'm not an active director at the moment. It's just I haven't done anything for 8 years as a director, and here I've come to Stratford and done 2 shows in a row.